Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Are you happy? You must be very happy, Pastor. Just sang a very nice song. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. And I think I should start saying it. You know, before whenever I preach, I will tell people, just relax. You know, sometimes we become so nervous, and even the preacher is also so nervous, but I don't want you to do that. I'm so relaxed. So I just want you to relax and receive from the Lord, as already Pastor said, you know, learn to rest. Hallelujah. And then he said, you know, for Joshua, and you know I'm going to speak from the life of Joshua.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Really, I wanted to sing a special song. You know, I can sing, but I don't sing because I think the music and all wouldn't match because of Hindi songs and Punjabi songs. So what I found is I found some alternative. I found some tracks. So I'm supposed to sing, but I couldn't prepare and all. So Pastor was singing, so I was ready. You know, as I wanted to do as well as singing. I couldn't prepare and Pastor is singing, you know, so well. You know, so in future. Well, I'll be singing for sure, but not today. Amen. Praise God. So, as you know that you, 2 weeks ago, I was preaching from the life of Joshua. I was preaching about God's commissioning to Joshua. Amen. And you know, I just realized that we have Pastor Joshua here. We have Pastor David, we have Pastor John, Peter, Deborah, so many biblical names are here, amen? Is it, you know?
Amen.
So, praise God. So Pastor, you know, I thought after I preached commissioning and all, I said, wow, nice. So I did not want to preach another sermon from that. I thought it's over. I have so many other sermons I will preach. But Pastor said, no, that was just introduction. You must continue. Praise God. I said, yeah, wow, that's awesome. So then what happened? Then I said, yes, you know, then I start preparing. And then I went through the book of Joshua and I begin to prepare. And not, you know, I'm going to close today, but I think some more sermons will come out of from the book of Joshua. Amen. Because there are many, many important lessons, many things that we can learn, but then we have to like implicate on our lives, and we have to implicate like in the New Testament manner, you know, under grace, with the New Testament, and being under the Holy Spirit and all these things. But still, we can learn so many amazing things from the biblical characters and many things from the Old Testament. Amen. The other day I was teaching on Thursday night. I visited my believers, some church members, the youths, and I was teaching them from the life of Joshua even earlier and then this time. And then I was speaking from that, and they were like, oh, you know, like wow, you know, I was speaking from the life of Joshua, the sun stood still, and this and that happened, and they were like, and I'm talking about Bible one, you know, because many of the time people miss many of the things from the Old Testament. And I tell you, now we have very busy life. We are so busy, so rushing. We are just, everything is fast food, fast Bible reading, fast prayer, everything very fast. So we miss to spend time with the Lord and learn and read, you know, many chapters and know so many things. And I was, you know, I surprised, and they say, this is so awesome, you know. We have many pastors spoke to us this, but nobody is teaching us from the Old Testament, you know, with the New Testament implication and all. But still, the characters and all, they didn't know. And to my surprise, they like, you know, they were so encouraged. And until one believer came to me, and you know, one of the youth, he said, Pastor, can you teach me to overcome fear? Because he was so encouraged from the life of Joshua. I was riding bike, you know. I said, I can teach you, but not now, you know. You must find some time and you know, spend at least 1 hour with me and I'll teach you. No, you tell me some verses. I said, how to tell you on bike? Praise God. So, you know, but many people, I tell you, they are really encouraged. And then there's a lot of things that people go through and they never let you know. We cover up very nice. We have everything well covered, what we go through, we do not share. Like old time, people will share with one another, and all people don't know, you know, don't do that. And that's why they suffer in silence, and they don't tell what they feel, what they go through, and you know. But God's word is always there. The people of God who are praying in the Spirit are always there to help and counsel and bring you such a comfort and such a healing. You know, even a word of encouragement, a word delivered from this platform right now, if you are just open to it, can transform your life to eternity. Amen?
Yes.
Amen? So that's why we will just go through very fast, and this is not the closing of the book of Joshua. This is just the beginning. Amen. Hallelujah. So today I will be speaking from the life of Joshua, and then Joshua and people of, you know, Joshua and Israelites crossing over Jordan. So that's what I will be covering today. Amen. And what we have, you know, like the other day I was speaking much on commissioning. God's commissioning to Joshua, I was speaking, and it was just the first nine verses. But after that, I think we must go flashback and we must learn more about a person, a general, a military man, a man of God. Then we must go into the flashbacks, and we must learn this character more deeply. Amen? Is that right?
Amen.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Because unless, you know, the other day I spoke, I said, I just want to give the, you know, little bit off. I just wanted to speak. I just wanted to encourage. I just wanted to tell you that you are Joshua, and you, if you are in the plan of God, you have to be strong. You have to say the word of God and this and that, and then you can, you know, do great and mighty things. I just wanted to speak a word of encouragement.
Hallelujah.
But when Pastor said continue, then I have to go deep down to the Joshua's life. And I think if we want to continue to learn from the book of Joshua,
yes,
we have to also know who was Joshua. Even just, you know, we speak, and then we later on we don't realize really, you know, deeply who was really Joshua. That's why I won't take much time. Previously, I remember I spoke from the life of David. So I like to speak from characters. You know, one day you'll hear me speak about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph for sure. But today is Joshua. Amen. So we will learn. First of all, Joshua was a son of Nun. You know, not Nun, you know. But his father's name was Nun. Amen. I think you know. And he was from the tribe of Ephraim, and he was born in Egypt in slavery. You must understand his background. Sometimes most of the time we complain so much about our background. I was born in poor family, my family was in the village, I was living, you know, people are from jungle and this and that, my country is so poor, my family, my father was like this and that. You must understand who was Joshua. Joshua was born into slavery. He was born, even Moses was born, in fact he was born there, but by the grace of God, he was raised up in the royal palace, you know, for 40 years, and everything well provided, and training and education, and you know, all. He was a really man with many talent and skilled person. But here on the other hand, Joshua is not so.
Yes.
He is not so. You must understand that he was born into slavery, and he was a, like slave under you know, Egyptians, and he had to be under the taskmaster. He has to be get beaten, he had to fulfill the task, he has to get abused. Can you just figure out what this person had gone through? And he was born into slavery, and you know, he was really tortured and not pampered like many of us here. Amen. You know, and then his original name was Hoshea. Hoshea, you know, Moses used to call him Joshua, but his original name was Hoshea. We call it, yeah, Hoshea. You know, Numbers chapter 13. Actually, I have all the references, but my style is just be straightforward and speak directly and not to go so much detail and puzzle you. So that's why actually I have all the verses for all these things. So his name was Hoshea, but Moses used to call him Joshua, which means Savior. Amen?
Amen.
You Pastor was telling, there's no singing. His name, Joshua, even though he was born in slavery, even though, you know, his tribe wasn't so great, Ephraim, you don't hear much about his tribe, you don't hear much about his family background, you don't see that his father was something so great and, you know, awesome, his tribe was so great and awesome, nothing much you hear about that. And then some more, he was born into slavery, but his name, you know, even that's why your name has very good, very much impact on life. And I'm so glad that my name is Victor. Amen.
Hallelujah.
True. And then the second name is Masi. Masi means Messiah. Wow. Hallelujah. So that's my name. Amen. So here is an original name is Hoshea, which means Savior. And all the meaning is he's a person by whom God is going to save. And also, if it was in Hebrew, it's Hoshea, but in Greek, it's equivalent to word Jesus. You know, the name of, you know, Hoshea, when it's in Hebrew, the name Hoshea or something like that, Joshua, is equivalent in Greek to the name of Jesus. Means, that's why it is, figuratively, we see in the book of Hebrew, even Pastor spoke from there, that later on, Joshua is compared with Jesus.
That's right.
You know? Joshua is compared with Jesus because also that because they have a similar name, and in the Old Testament he's figuratively a figure of Jesus Christ leading the people of Israelites to cross over Jordan and bringing them to the place of blessing, bringing them to the place of abundance, bringing them to the place of milk and honey, bringing them to the place where they did not plant but they can harvest, when they did not, you know, do anything but everything they get just free. Amen. So that's why his name is also very powerful, even though whatever he went through, he has go through whatever his background, but his name, you must know, you know, that's what was his name, and that there was a purpose of God behind it. Amen. And also, if I go into more flashback, you know, Joshua, you know, he was this he may have to go through training. He was in the wilderness 40 years with Moses. And Moses was training him, and he was, you know, we see him in the earlier book of Exodus that he went and fought with I think Amalekites. He was fighting with them, yes, Amalekites. And then Joshua was praying for him, and when Joshua would stretch out his hand, he will win. When his hands will go down, he will lose. And then the two people came and held his hand. Later on, they also cannot hold. Their hands also get tired, and they put him on the stone. But Joshua took the victory. Amen. So Joshua was getting trained for how many years? 40 years. I tell you, there's hardly even 4 months they come to the church and they want to be the senior pastor. Amen. You know, they want to be. 4 years also is very, very hard for them to wait. But Joshua was a man. You know, he was really under the mentorship, and he was prepared, and he was trained, and he was chastened, you know, given a lot of work, got a lot of duties and everything, and he had patience. He already suffered enough in Egypt. He got, you know, delivered him, and he come to the wilderness, and you think his job was very easy? There is no such thing. His job was very 40 long years. Today we, you know, everybody want anointing, the gifting of the Holy Spirit, and this and that, but nobody wants to be trained, nobody wants to be mentored, nobody wants to spend time with God, but people want shortcuts. Today we don't have Simon the Peters, but we have Simon the sorcerers who want to, you know, buy the anointing. Amen. They bring their money, they go over, they fly to America, they ask a pastor to pray and blow the anointing in them, and then, oh, I came from America and I have anointing, I have gifting, oh, this is that prophet and this and that. You know? But nobody wants to spend the time like Joshua did. That's why I say before you understand commissioning and what he's doing, you must understand the person. 40 long years of preparation. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. You know, now we have VDH at all 3 years. You know, where you can set aside some time and learn day and night. And no, but in earlier, you see, in earlier years, you know, when Abraham, how many years, you know, he had to walk and get trained by the Lord, you know. Then you even see Moses, for 40 years he was in the wilderness, 40 years in the palace, then he was with his father-in-law, and 40 long years and prepared, and then at the age of 80, God bring him out, and next 40 years, you will know what he was doing. And then here we see Joshua also getting trained, getting mentored by Moses for 40 long years. That's why we must understand our calling, what is our role in the body of Christ, who we are, what we have to do. Is it to be mouth or is it to be hands, you know, to provide? Is it to be helping hand? Is it to be work under? Is it to work above? Everything we must understand and operate in our role in the body of Christ. So you must understand, Joshua was trained for 40 years. Amen?
Amen.
Second thing that which our pastor always teach, Joshua had the ability to hear from God very clearly. Not just, you know, doubts about it, not just maybe, is it God or is it just my flesh or is it my pastor always saying like that, you know? Is it, you know, he wasn't like that. Bible says very clearly, whenever it comes about Joshua talking to God, he hearing from very clear. God spoke to Joshua. Like I can tell you, you know, Joshua, that's why God said, it's not, you know, sometimes I was saying to you the other day, God, he'll be with you like Moses, this and that will happen, no man will stand before you, and you feel, wow, so nice, but you must understand where it is coming from. Why God said, I will be with you like as I was with Moses, because he was as close to as God as Moses. Are you listening to me? He's the only person that he accompanied. You know, he accompanied Moses to the Mount of Sinai. He didn't go to see God, but nobody even could go near the Mount Sinai when God was there. But he has the ability, the purity, the preparation, the anointing to go and accompany him. You know, he said, "You wait." God said, Moses said, "You wait here." You know, was keeping him. So really, he had that much of relationship and you know, preparation. And he was as good as Moses, I tell you. Joshua was as good as Moses. That's why God said, I will be with you as I was with Moses. Even people, that's why these people feared him. And that's why even the people in the second chapter, people said, actually I don't have the detail. In the second chapter, people themselves said, you go, you do whatever you want to do, and God will be with you as he was with Moses. What God said, people confirmed, and that's what God did in his life. That's why you must understand, he had the ability to hear from God, walk into that closeness with God, intimacy with God. That's why, you know, here we are learning a training place. We must go, we set aside some time where we pray, we worship, where we bring our thoughts to subjection, where we hear from God very clearly, not with doubts, not with anything else, but you hear God very clearly. Very clearly that you have no doubt, no pressure, nothing to take you away from the focus that God has given you. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Many verses, even we have just read from the book of Joshua, 1st chapter 1, verse 1, it says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke to Joshua. Even in chapter 3, verse 7, the word of God says, if I want to read, it says, the Lord said to Joshua, this day I will begin to magnify you in the sight of all Israel. So God was speaking very clearly to him. And I'm so glad that here Pastor is always teaching us to listen to God. Here, you know, that we must, God clearly, we must listen to God and we must. No, the Bible says, God, many verses in chapter 4, verse 15, 5, 2, 9, 6, 5, 2 and 9, chapter 6, verse 2, 7, 10, all through the book of Joshua, you will find this phrase, God spoke to Joshua. If he couldn't hear, you know, I was saying all this commissioning, if he couldn't hear God, he couldn't accomplish the task that God has given him. Many of the ministries fail today because they don't hear from God. They want to use their own wisdom. They have a lot of cash. and then they have wisdom, and then they have cash, and then they have muscles also to scare people, you know. Oh, pastor goes to gym and with muscle, if anybody will do anything, you know. Then they do that. I'm not kidding. I saw that kind of people even this week, and there is even in India. I haven't met many or much here in Malaysia because I think I'm not connected with so many pastors. But I tell you, people, you know, just want to push through. But it won't happen until and unless you have relationship with God, intimacy with God, and ability to hear from God like Joshua. That's why the Bible says, you know, do not boast on your strength, on your money. Money can't do. You know what your relationship with God can do. Even the strength, wisdom, nothing. But we must know God. He said, he who wants to glory, let him glory. God says that he knows me. So Joshua was a person who knew God. Amen? Amen. Let's clap for Joshua. You know, he will be very happy. Amen. Maybe some angel will go and tell Pastor Victor is preaching about you, you know. And he had that ability. That's why another thing come to my mind, actually just know when I said come to my mind, it came to my mind but went off. But now come to my mind. Okay? You know? And you know, Joshua, Moses was a man who led people of Israelite from out of Egypt. So this is, when I see in the spiritual senses, it is a salvation experience which many people experience in the church. They are in the hands of devil, they are in the sin, under Egypt and under Pharaoh is the devil, and you know a lot of things, spiritualizing. And many people experience this, but not all people cross over Jordan. You know, and it will depend. That's why even people who sit in the church, people who come to the church, they never experience the land, the promised land, and that blessing, that abundance and everything, because when the time of wilderness and desert come afterward, surely the enemy will attack. I guarantee everybody who will come out of that, and enemy will come after and attack and this and that. So it will depend how they behave in the wilderness. Why Joshua and Caleb made it to cross over the Jordan and to the promised land? Only because they were men of faith. Even Moses himself couldn't make to the land of promise. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
People came out of faith. They enjoyed the free manna, free food. Everybody want to enjoy it. So they had free manna from heaven. The food came. And when they complained, no water, then the water also came. You know? And when they said, always roti canai, always roti canai. Then God even sent the quills, you know. Always, you know, God even brought the meat for them all, but they still couldn't believe God. They still couldn't trust God. So many people are like that. They see God at work, God is moving with them, they know Jesus is with them, everything, come to the church, get the blessing, everything, but they will still not make to cross over the Jordan and experience that abundance and experience the, you know, the land of promise and all. So that's why the second experience that believers must go through is cross over Jordan. Amen.
Amen.
And I tell you, I remember I said that I will help many people to cross over Jordan. Amen. Hallelujah. So here, that's why you must have this ability. If you want to have people to enter into the blessings of God and into the abundance of God and supernatural provisions of God, then you must be like Joshua. Otherwise, the commissioning, you know, that's why you must understand. This person was very intimate with God. That's it. The third thing, very important, which I can actually say from all the characters of the Bible, and you might say, Pastor Victor, whenever say Abraham, man of faith, whenever say Joshua, man of faith, whenever say man of faith. But I tell you, I have to be sincere. And you know, he was a man of faith. Because Joshua is conquering the land which he himself spied. In Exodus chapter 13, they went, and then the 14th they came and they gave a report. And Joshua was man of faith, and even two people only, Joshua and Caleb, give the positive report, and other 10 people gave negative report. That's why you must understand, sometimes there will be majority of people giving the wrong advice, saying negative things, will not agree with you, but that if you know you have a relationship with God and what you have heard from God very clearly, and then you are operating by the faith and you are operating by the word of God, don't believe them. And Joshua, why he was a man of, he didn't fail him, these people, they were with them, you know. You must understand the situation. Sometimes we just biblical things, we don't implicate, we don't properly understand. You must understand, these people were living among them, these people traveled with them, they had long trip to the land of Canaan and they lived together, they must have discussions together, they must be making, oh, you know, Moses sent us, we must go and tell him, and they must, the 10 people must be saying them, you know, it's no good, we must go and tell them, please don't come here, you know, otherwise monsters are waiting for us. 10 people were always pursuing them, always telling them to be inactive, always, you know, everything, but they still, they don't care, they don't believe them. And Joshua and Caleb, they give the positive report and they have faith, because here, that's why the word of God is a day and night, you must meditate on the word of God. They say, we don't believe what we see in the natural with the eyes, we don't walk by sight, but walk by faith. Amen. We don't believe those monsters, that you know, that giants or all the tribes. What we believe is the word of God. What we believe is the promise of God. What we believe, what God has promised Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and to give his descendants. That's what we believe. And that's why he was a man of faith. And only, to my surprise, only because their two people believed and they only made to the land of Canaan. The other couldn't make. That's a faith. What we believe has really big impact on our lives, you know. That's what I was saying in the wilderness. If people, they complain and all this, and they will never make to the land of promise. They will never enter that rest, like Pastor was saying. They never experience that abundance and that peace and that sense of, you know, security and really abundance and feeling of the Holy Spirit. Because Joshua and Caleb had you know, that faith. And that's why Joshua, you know, he refused what other 10 people. The majority doesn't change the promise of God's will. The majority doesn't change what, you know, what the word of God is saying. That's why you must be like Joshua if you want to be receive the blessing like Joshua received. That's why. And he stood on God's word and he did all these things. So this only. These are only three things I want to especially bring from the life of Joshua. So you know God commissioned Joshua, and now you know Joshua a little bit more better. Amen?
Yeah.
Let's come. Let's go forward. Actually, my watch is also not here. The timepiece is also not here. And I have to check it here. Amen. I think I have to check on laptop. Amen. Praise God. Okay. So now what happened? God commissioned him. He heard God very nice, and we if we go to the, you know, I think I must recap my sermon, and we know what happened. That okay, this recap for you if somebody wasn't here. God spoke to Joshua, and God asked him to arise and leave whatever is behind, everything, you know, and rise up and go forward. And God said, I will be with you as I was with Moses. And God said that you have to be very strong and courageous if you have to go and, you know, take that land. Yes. And then the other thing God said, you know, that you have to also stay focused on the word of God, and without that you cannot do it. Amen. So these were all things I told earlier that happened, that God spoke to Joshua. Amen. So now, just from the verse 10. What happened then after God had finished speaking to him in the first 9 verses? Let's say he was in his tent, he was somewhere, he was writing the book, he was, you know, and God spoke to him and he wrote the book of Joshua, and he, you know, he came, and then he came over and 10 verses, he acted upon it. Most of the people fail to act. They listen, and as Pastor was saying, always, Eat, never exercise, become fat. Always take sprinkle milk, get sprinkle diarrhea. Always, you know, this and that. So never act. Means they never act on the word of God and have a lot of brain hemorrhage and heart problem and this and that. Whatever we can say. Because They do, when the spiritually people are suffering with these kind of things because they never act on the word of God. But here we see the verse 9 completed, and then the Joshua come out of his tent. And Joshua, what he says in verse 10, he says, chapter 1, verse 10. So we will have long ride to the book of Joshua, even now and later on. But I'll just put a few words I will say, and we will just help Joshua, and along with him will cross over Jordan. Amen. Yes. And then Joshua commanded officers of the people, saying, pass through the camp and command the people, saying, prepare provisions for yourself, for within 3 days you will cross over this Jordan to go into the to possess the land which the Lord your God is giving to you to possess. Amen. So first thing you must see, after the commissioning happened, then he had to prepare for it. Lot of the people, they never prepared. Many of the people haven't responded to the Great Commission. They never share the gospel. They never share the testimony because they never prepared for it. Are you listening to me? I think I say relax, but everybody become very nervous. You must listen, you know. These people, they never prepared. Here Joshua, he knew he had to cross over Jordan. Yes. And he just said, okay, God already said, let's go. And you know, just like that, he did not say that. And you know, they had to prepare for it. And that's why after the 10 verse, he come out, he tell to the officers, people in charge over the tribes and all. And he come and speak to them, go and tell them that you must prepare for the 3 days, the provision and everything that you are going to cross over, because we are going to cross over Jordan. That's why preparation is very, very important. If we don't prepare, we cannot do anything. Are you with me?
Yes.
Please wave your hand. I'm thinking, you know, maybe you're not liking my sermon. You know. I have certain feeling is coming to me.
I'm just listening.
God, you know, he asked people to prepare themselves.
Yes.
That's why even for Sunday, you must prepare, you know. You must prepare what dress I must wear, what makeup I must wear. You know, like what ladies think. Man, you must, you know what, God, I should be here, everything, you must pray, you must go with expectation,
yes.
What God wants to speak to me, God speak to me about this and everything, you know, you must have that preparation.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. You know, in Punjab, they say, Pastor Vidal say, hallelujah, hallelujah, people cannot sleep. Amen, hallelujah. But here we don't say as much of hallelujah, but we say amen, hallelujah. So he asked them to prepare for it.
Yes.
That's why before you enter into God's blessing, you receive a miracle, and you have to prepare for it.
Amen.
Nothing happens automatically. There's a lot of people receiving the best of God because a lot of fake gospel, fake things are preached, and they say, okay, just sit, I will speak from here, and the things will happen in your life, you know, nothing happens like that. You must prepare,
yes,
to cross over Jordan. You must prepare to experience God. You must,
yes,
prepare to go over Jordan. You must prepare to receive the miracles.
Amen.
You can't be lazy like described in the book of Proverbs, and you say, God never did anything good in my life. Because you never did anything for God. You never, you know, even spent time with God. You never left God's word. You never even contributed to the kingdom of God. You never stood with the pastor. You never did anything for God. And then you expect God to do everything for you. God already sent a mission to you. God already, you know, told you. God already spoke everything very briefly, detailed in the word of God for you, but you still did nothing. You heard, and then you get spiritual diarrhea, and then you sit in the toilet. How do you go over the Jordan? Really, I like it. Pastor spoke there, you know. You must check with Pastor Neil, you know, if he doesn't like it. Really, you know. And he asked them to prepare for it.
Yes.
Second thing, He sent out the spies. You know, this is the third. Actually, I don't want to go to the details. Then there's 2.5 tribes of Israel. Moses already gave them the land. He said, you, these three, these the tribes are Reubenites and Gadites and half tribe of Manasseh. These tribes must stay over, you know, here on the other side of the Jordan. They don't need to cross over. Moses already divided the land for them. And he said, but your warriors must go. So, preparation. He says, okay, la, you also stay there. Your warrior also stay. No need. We can do everything. What are you, you know? No, he's not like he army man. He's a military man. He's a general. He know he need people. He said, you can take this land, but your people must go and fight with your brethren. Amen. No, he was preparing them. Must have the preparation. That's why I'm so glad I'm here. Your pastor is always so good in preparation. You know, I tell you, I must I'm also not that as good as him in preparation yet. But I'm learning. Amen. I must prepare, you know. He asked them to prepare earlier. Not on the spot, not just we stand on the bank, you know, of Jordan, and then we prepare ourselves. Let's prepare ourselves. Wear a swimming suit, wear this and that. No, you know, you must take 3 days to make your provision, make food, everything. The other side, you have to go and, you know, you have to put the tents and you have to do set up and everything. You must get ready. Amen. And here he has to prepare. Then he sent out the spies. In the chapter 3, we see the story of, you know, Rahab and the spies and all in chapter 2. If you know the story, if you have read your Bible, you must have known the story that they went and then, okay, just read the verse for you. Now, in the verse 1 says, chapter 2, verse 1. Now, Joshua the son of Nun sent out 2 men from Acacia Grove to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. Not simply, you know, many people's spiritual life is wrecked because they don't know even how the devil will pray and how the, you know, all the flesh will and all these things, they don't know anything. And they will just say, you know, I'm fine, I just go and, you know, like that, and then they cannot do anything. Joshua already went and fight this land, you must know. Joshua already went and he saw those great walls, but he said, please go and check again. Maybe there's some changes happened already, you know. True or not? He asked him to do that. He said, go and you spy the land. Then we see the Rahab, you know, they went into Jericho and she hide them and they made promise that we won't kill you. And she asked them to worry and lot of things. And they knew the state of the people, that people were afraid of them. On the other hand, many of the time, our enemies are also scared of us and we are also scared of situation. But Joshua wanted to make sure, he sent out everything, spy out, and he said to go over and check. Spiritual, I want you to look at your life. Most of the things we are, our enemy is scared of us. Yes. Devil is scared of us. Demons are scared of us.
Yes.
And we are scared of them. Yes. How? Why come like that? My English, you know, I have to bring my why come English, that's why. How come like that? Maybe this white term is company, you know, the movie company. Maybe I'm promoting them. How come? We also scared of our enemies, and we are scared of the walls of Jericho and everything. But the truth is, the devil is scared of us because of Jesus. A lot of things. Yeah. And he was good military, you know. Man, he wanted to make sure everything is in control. He sent out the spies and it's all called preparation. Amen. 3 days here, the people, the families are preparing, and for 3 days these people were spying. And then when they were, you know, they were informed and they cross over, and then Rahab said, 3 days you must, you know, hide yourself and all. It means they didn't cross over before these people went back and gave them the report.
Swear.
Amen.
Yeah.
Are you with me? So, must prepare. If you want to conquer anything in your life, if you want to accomplish anything in your life, if you want to receive a miracle, it won't happen automatically.
Amen.
You must do something about it. You know, you don't say that I'm not preaching grace or I'm not, you know, I'm asking you to pray in the words and all. No, everything you're going to receive is the favor of God, is the unmerited favor of God, is what you don't deserve, is the grace of God, is what Jesus has done, is because of the Holy Spirit, but you must have faith to act on it.
Hallelujah.
If you don't act on it by faith, you will not receive it. It won't make any difference in your life. That's why you must prepare. Nothing you receive automatically. If it's everything is automatically, God is sovereign. Yes, there is nobody higher than Him. But many people misunderstand the sovereignty of God. Still, God would not force even a single person to believe Him. Are you listening to me? It's still to the people to accept the message, reject the message, to act upon it, to work on it. Still, God wouldn't force anybody to do anything. People have to respond. That's why, you know, that's how if Bible says God wants all the people to be saved, but all the people are not saved because all the people don't have faith and they don't act on it. Actually, the Hebrew chapter 4, that's why it says people, Israelites heard the word, but they did not mix it with faith.
That's right.
And many people are sitting in the church and many even preaching the gospel in that way that you don't have to mix it by faith and then you don't have to do anything about it. But that's not true. If you have faith, then you will really act upon it. Amen?
Amen.
If you're not acting on it, it means you don't have faith.
Right.
It means you have fear, you have unbelief, you have doubts, you have all. That's why you are not there. I tell you, if you have faith and you are well convinced of the word of God, you will not sit silent. Amen?
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 That's why Joshua had to prepare for it and he asked people to prepare. Amen? They prepare and then we know, actually you can bring a lot of things from here, but I want to just let's go to Jordan. Amen. Who want to go to Jordan? You know the Jordan by Israel? Amen. So that Jordan is there, but this Jordan is the spiritual, and here we see that Joshua and the people of Israel, you know, they had to cross over Jordan. Let's look into Jordan for a while. Actually, I won't spend much time. Next time, I'll start from Jordan. I think my time is also running very fast. Amen? Okay. So what happened in the book of Jordan? So ignore the book of Jordan. You see, you're not focusing. If I say book of Jordan, you should already know that. In the book of Joshua, Captain 3, and then they come to their bed prepared. You're not listening, you know.
Give your grace and mercy.
Bible says, amen. Praise God. That's why he's asking to relax, you know. I'm not relaxing. Bible chapter 3 verse 1 says, then Joshua rose early. Amen. Not only prepare, okay, now everything is prepared, I should sleep until 12. are you listening to me? Like run the race like rabbit. You know, tortoise cannot come, better I take some rest. Otherwise my legs will break. You know, maybe then I can feel it. But he, after preparation, he says, he rose early in the morning. Amen?
Amen.
I'm not going to absolve myself, but just to tell you, when I was in India for 19 days, I did not sleep enough. Because 19 days, my days spent in travel left 14 days, and 14 days, 21 meetings. How to do it? Actually, you know, I did it, and even pastors, how come you do it? You have to travel, you're coming after 4 years, and this and that, you cannot do it. It's not possible, but I say, I don't care. I say, you know, I didn't sleep enough for 19 days. I slept for 3 to 4 hours. Only 3 to 4 hours. And I will just, late night, I'm, you know, sleeping, wake up early morning, pray, and put messages, praise God, all the sermons were prepared. Otherwise, I'd write over the preaching, you know, I don't know such thing. All was prepared, all the sermons, but only I had to prepare myself. I had to dress up myself, I had to wake up early, and everybody, people wake up, and I'm sitting on their dining table, drink the tea, you know, kind of things. Everything, you must prepare. You must know that you are a warrior of the Lord, that who you are in the Lord, and you must prepare. If you are not different, you don't do anything, you don't prepare yourself, then you just won't make it. Amen. And Joshua woke up early in the morning, and they set out from Acacia Grove and came to the Jordan. Amen. And then they went, and the Israel, you know, they came to the bank and they want to cross. Now very, very good truth, you know, things are there. Then Bible again says that God spoke to Joshua. Amen. When they went there and, you know, he asked them to bring the Ark of the Covenant, and the people must carry and everything, you know, and the priest will carry, and they have to go forward. And when God spoke to them, he said, when they will go, and it was not the right time to cross. You must understand, this was the time of harvest, and Bible itself says, I'm not bringing some dictionary or anything. Actually, my Bible also is not study Bible. This is the Bible that my Bible college gave me. The paper come out and everything. So, that's what, you know, Bible itself says. That harvest time, what will do, the water even will go to the banks, and you know, it will just spread over, because it will be very heavily flowing. And it wasn't the right time to cross over. That's why when we look in the, no, this is not the time. This is not the, God cannot bless us. This time we cannot cross over. This time maybe I must hit a lottery and decide that something can happen. Although, you know, people are like that. They want to see everything, but it was, even I tell you, the tribes that were living in the Canaan, they never expected that Joshua and the Israelites will cross over. They never expected that this time they will come over and attack them. Attack the enemy in very unexpected manner, you know. They will never think Pastor Victor will go and preach like this, you know. He will never expect that Pastor Victor will go and do this many meetings. He will try to instill fear and this and that. You cannot do this many meetings. You are going after 4 months. Even, you know, and your immunity is not good. You are like Malaysian. You will get sickness. You are like this. You know, all these things will come up. But you don't believe. You must believe what God asks you to do. And you know you are praying in the will of God. This is the plan of God. This is the purpose of God. And you will do it. And you have God's help. You have everything. And they never expected it, but Bible says that they. Then he said, when you will send the priest, this priest will just ask them to go. And when they will go, you know, it's not who you stand. Like what they call, like the Red Sea, you know, Red Sea already crossed already, and then they, okay, everything is fine, I won't sing, so, you know, like this, everything is standing, so I will go. No, this time God said, these priests must go, and when they will put their feet in the water. Are you listening to me? This time is different. Not like that. He said, when they will put their feet, will touch the water will stand like the walls. Amen? Most of the time, they say, when we don't prepare, when we won't get ready, when we never go and face the situation, nothing happens.
That's right.
Nothing happens. Yesterday, even Pastor Sidhu was preaching. He just blessed the bread and the fish, and nothing happened. He asked them to sit. The disciples must be thinking what's going to happen. But when they start distributing, it kept on increasing. The miracle in Canaan did not happen, you know. Okay, Jesus Christ said, if Jesus can turn water into wine, he can just pray and the wine can come into, wine can be just automatically come into the gallons, right? And nothing, no, he asked them to fill the water. And they had to, you know, have faith to fill the water, and most surprisingly, take out this water and give. You know, then the miracle will happen. And here, they say when the feet will touch, and then the water will stand like walls. Amen. So people have to go there. They have to really prepare the miracle is going to happen. They have to really prepare the permission. So everything they have to find it that way and do it that way. Amen. And that's how it happened. Next time I will just start from here. I think the time is, you know, I don't want to take much time. And I don't want you to overeat also, not drink anything. I must feed you as much as you can digest, because this is mutton, biryani. Amen. And these people, they did accordingly. Amen. And when, okay, the other thing I just want to speak and then close. When they touched it, the water stood still. And the water was just like walls, you know. and they are crossing over. And then the next thing is very, very interesting also. Then when you put God in front, the covenant, you know, they must carry the Ark of the Covenant, and we know in the Ark of the Covenant is the Ten Commandments, the budding, the staff of Aaron, and then they have manna, right? So then they are bringing the glory of God, the presence of God, the mercy seat of God, and then when they do. And now another thing, then he said they must stand and go to the other side, but they shouldn't come up. When you put God in front, and then God will make sure that miracle really happens. God said these people shouldn't go out. Other side, they must go and still stand inside until all the people pass through. Then only they must come out. Are you listening? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
How much when you do as God says, God will do everything in your favor when you prepare yourself, when you have faith, when you pray according to the word of God. God will make sure that you cross over Jordan. Amen?
Yes.
God won't let you sink. God won't let you be ashamed. God won't let you get mocked by the you know, tribes living in the land of Canaan. Oh, these people try to cross over wrong time, and then, you know, this happened. The priest by mistake come out, you know, cannot happen like that. And they all get sick and this and that. No. If you follow the instructions of God, that cannot happen. God will make sure that you cross over Jordan and come to the land of Canaan. Amen?
Amen.
These people went, and then God is God. So actually the other point, I just tell you. And then he said, take the 12 people from every tribe. They must take the stones from the feet of the priest, and these people must carry those 12 stones and put it where you're gonna tent, where you're gonna stay tonight, where you're gonna pitch your tents. You must put the stones there as a memorial. Amen? You must think of your future generation. Amen?
Yes.
You must remember what God did you in previous, when you were in trouble. You must remember always what God did for you. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. So we will continue. Now we are already crossed over Jordan. Then we must go and break the walls of Jericho. And then we must go to Ai. Then we must make the sun stand still. Then we must stop rain. You know, here we'll stop the rain, you know. My wife will do that. She said, Commander, the rain, let my clothing dry. So we will go through it. Amen. And I tell you, I'm really, really loving it. I really like to preach from the book of Joshua. Amen. I'm really, really thankful to Pastor for asking me to preach. Otherwise, I will never go much details to it. Amen.
Yes.
So God bless you all. We'll continue from here. God bless you all. And thank you so much.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Would you come? Hallelujah. By Julius and Elias. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Julius and Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Are you blessed this morning, church?
Amen.
I like what Pastor Victor said, that we need to prepare. Amen. You want to be blessed, you need to prepare. Amen. Prepare, you will receive less blessing. But if you prepare, you will receive more blessing. Amen. Hallelujah. I remember some time ago, there was a lack of water rationing. Then they say that the water truck is coming. You know? So it depends on how you prepare. You only have a small pill, there's only as much as you can collect. Amen. You have a big pill, then you can keep it for many days. Isn't that right? So it's very important, you know, what Victor said. Preparation is important for us to receive greater blessings. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We're going to sing the song. I think I asked Julius to sing this key. You know, song. You are. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, congratulations. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.